And with that, we will go ahead and jump into our first presentation, which is going to be from Sinan Bokasoy. So Sinan is a lifelong music producer, and he's been involved in post-production, and he is also the owner of the music tech company called Sonic Lab. He used to live in Paris, but now he is in Istanbul, and he is going to be talking about stochastic methods, so generative music, generative synthesis. And I will now hand it over to Sinan. Take it away.
Thank you to Audio Programmer team for this opportunity. Let me share my screen. Great. So I like to divide my presentation on these topics, like the introduction to probability distributions and the famous vanguard music composer of 20th century, Axanakis, and his foundations in stochastic music, coding the probability distributions in C++, and some applications of stochastic synthesis on available Sonic Lab software. So let me read a few phrases. Typical definitions of probability distribution is the mathematical function that gives the probabilities of events with possible outcomes in an experiment. So this is the general topic of probability distribution. And in our case, the experiment will be the musical applications. So this is a mathematical description of a random phenomenon in terms of its event sample space and the probabilities of these events to happen. From the events, we can talk in musical terms, the events which cause some audio or some musical idea. And the last one is the stochastic behavior can be analyzed statistically, but may not be predicted precisely. So we can analyze the behavior, we can define it with a mathematical formula, but we cannot say precisely which event will happen. So it has this stochastic behavior. So quickly, I go to the first experiment to introduce you the probability distributions, which is a basic dice which we throw and which has six surfaces, and each surface is numbered. And as we know, the probability of each surface to happen is equal in this case to 1/6. So the total sum of the probability of possible events equals to one. We can say that each surface has the same chance, the amount of chance to happen. We call such a distribution the uniform random distribution, because as you see on the graph below and at the bottom of the page, there is this probability axis and the event axis. So there are six discrete events, and each has the same probability. And the area below the probability line and the x-axis should equal to one. That's the necessity of defined probability experiment. So this second experiment is here, which I recorded on a street next to me. You see a street light failing to run continuously. So how can we model such a behavior? And it turns out that an ideal distribution is called a binomial distribution with this equation there, and you don't need to really memorize these things. But I like to introduce how to run the binomial distribution in our case. So assume that you enter to the room, you turn on the room light, and you know it's not working perfectly. So there is a chance that it will not turn on the light, or it will turn on. So let's assume we try this 11 times, which is the n consecutive trials in that equation here, and assume that the probability of a successful attempt is like 50%, like 0.5. And in that case, the probability of failure will be again the 50%, the other 50%. And then the binomial distribution of such conditions here is the bottom right figure. So out of 11 experiments there, the highest chance that six of them is successful. So if we try to turn on this light 11 times, there is a chance that six of them will be successful. And on the figure on the bottom left of this page, you see that the probability of success is less than 50%, because it says us like three of these trials, 11 trials, may be successful. So this is an example model how we can simulate such an stochastic behavior. So the next one, the third one, is again something I recorded. Sorry, this is not very playing smoothly. Well, anyway, you hear the crackles of the fire and burning wood. And this is a stochastic phenomenon again. And I like to simulate this phenomenon with a distribution called Cauchy, which has a formula like that. And the particular thing of this distribution is it's a continuous distribution. So it's a curve, but you see, and as on the figure, where the first two experiments, they were discrete probability distributions. So this one is a continuous. Why I did choose a continuous distribution here? Because I'm trying to simulate this experiment with time. We can count that time is continuous if you are not in quantum levels. So the time between cracks, and also you can say that each crack has a different intensity. So some of them are soft and some of them are really sharp. And this distribution fits well to simulate such kind of experiment. So let's say I'm using the formula with these parameters 2 and 0.5. And it says us that like the most probable behaviors that there is like 2 seconds between the cracks in that case. But you can use different parameters and the curve changes as you see there. So we have many distributions in statistics, science of statistics. So continuous distributions and discrete distributions, which fit well to the purpose. So the most famous ones are like the, or used ones are like the uniform and the Gaussian. And sorry, I used 3S there, it should be 2. And what do we do with all these probability distributions? We can, by using them, we can introduce continuous transitions between order and disorder. So a strict order is like having a space with one single outcome. So there is a dictator and whatever he says, we should obey. And the disorder, perfect disorder, is like a space with all possible outcomes and a random distribution of them, which is in this case can be perfectly the uniform random distribution. So we use all these distributions and the parameters in real time to generate this transition between order and disorder. Next, I will show you a compositional technique introduced by the avant-garde composer Yannis Exenakis. So this controlled randomness gives us a generative design tool which can be applied on any level of musical structures, which I will show next. Again, an algorithm means like using a function to solve something in computing environments. So by using this controlled randomness or the behavior, this kind of behavior, we can simulate an algorithmic process, I mean, computed process of change. And this can generate us the musical interesting forms. So now we are entering to the field of music, musicology. And I introduce you to Yannis Exenakis, a phenomenal composer, architect, engineer, and theorist of 20th century. He has been considered as a mathematical composer, and his music is kind of possesses a natural power and physicality. He has this book called, which one is this one? For many, it is the lingua franca of avant-garde music, and I would say like the computer music. And his lifelong achievements and developments on this field is immense. And he has documented most of them in detail on this book, which I have studied like 20 years ago in Paris when I started my studies in electronic music. This, for this unit, you see, this is, there is a code in Fortran. And even some later you will see in code examples in BASIC. And he started developing these ideas in 1950s and on a level where no one else did reach at that time. But this book is needs some engineering degree. I mean, the mathematical level inside this book is really something you have to have a degree in that field. So next, I will try to introduce you the basic concepts in stochastic music, in the foundations of stochastic music, which he has developed. So consider a time cell where we distribute some events which will produce us some sounds. So I define a rectangle here, which possesses like n seconds of time. And we have to distribute some sonic entities in this area, the time cell. And Xenakis has used the Poisson distribution to define the density of events in that particular time cell. So as you see on this curve, there is a lambda parameter, and they have shown an example curves like one for the parameters 1, 4, and 10. Let's consider the lambda as 10, and the black curve there tells us that the if we try to distribute 20 events, and this distribution will use this curve to decide how many. So as you see, it's the most probably give us 10 events, the density of 10 events, but it can change like between 0 and 20. And when you change the lambda, the curve also changes. And then, for example, for lambda equals to 4, you see the green curve there. And so our events or our sonic entities should have an onset time and duration. So consider it as a usual score, and on a classical score notation, you have you can see where each note starts and how long it is. So he used the exponential distribution for this, and you see the curve and the various parameter examples of this curve on that figure. And for a sonic event, we have to define the pitch and the amplitude. And Xenakis has introduced the phenomenon called the continuous glissandi. So a glissando is a musical gesture, especially used on string instruments. It's like a continuous sounding change in pitch with a start and ending note, okay? And how can we calculate this kind of glissandi? So as you see, it has a starting offset and it has a velocity. So the higher the velocity, the steeper this curve, the glissandi. And the basic linear formula for this is like the GT equals S plus velocity multiplied by time. So we can model this kind of stochastic glissandi with probability distribution. So we can decide the starting offset with uniform distribution and the velocity with Gaussian distribution. Gaussian distribution is famous shape, which is a it's a bell shape looking distribution, and it is symmetrical around its center. And so as you see on our blue rectangle area, I have drawn some glissandis, and then the color shade also exemplifies the continuous change in amplitude. So this is a score of Xenakis, which he composed, the famous score, it's called Metastasis in 1953. All these curves there, which look like a mathematical or architectural design, should are scores for string instruments, individual string instruments. So each player is responsible of completing a glissandi at different pitch levels and time. And then we can, of course, continue to develop our musical structure with more cells and also having multiple layers of them. So why not having just one cell or one layer of it? So I will play some examples of his music, and which sonic content of these events can we hear? I mean, and in the case of Exanakis, there are, of course, many composed pieces. The famous piece is called Pitoprakta, 1955, means actions through probability. What you see is a graphical score, because I preferred that so that you can hear and understand the visual equivalent much easier than a traditional notation. And in that piece, Exanakis drew an analogy between the expansion of gas molecules through the space and that of string instruments through the pitch range. And with the same concept, there is another, let me play this first. Okay, my video is not scrolling smoothly. I don't know what to do about that, because it's, I guess, the computers. Anyway, with the same concept, there is another very famous piece called Atmosphere by Gheorghe Ligeti, which has been the soundtrack of the famous movie A Space Odyssey of Stanley Kubrick. But that piece is composed a bit later. This is the acoustic instrument composition. I mean, it uses the full orchestral elements based on these formulas and the outcomes of these distributions, which were done at that time by hand, of course, and there were not even maybe the calculator. And the next example I'm going to give is the potential, I mean, the possibilities of a electronic music studio of that time, and which is, like, in our case, the GRM, Groupe Recherche Musicale, Radio France, in 1951, which is founded by Pierre Schaeffer. And this studio has been known as the hub, real hub of music concrete. So, of course, at that time, they were using concrete tape recordings and the sliced reels of tape to be processed, and used some mixing techniques to conclude a composition of electronic piece. So this piece is called Concrete Payage, and it's using the recordings of the firecrackers, which I played you before, sort of the burning wood or charcoal. And then Exanakis has used one second of slices of these tape recordings, and he recalculated, make the montage of layering and transposing and creating an evolving density out of it. So let me play that. One of the particular things of the piece is, like, what you hear is like the really continuous transformation of density and spectral continuity. And this is made by discrete cuts of 1 second long tape reels. And until that time, at music concrete, you would not reach that level of continuous transformation. So this is an example piece which could achieve this. And this is one of the also first examples of like ambient music maybe. So all these computations of probability distributions and generation, the events, the parameters for these sonic entities are of course in the control of the composer. So Xanakis, although he laid the foundations of generative music structure where these formulas or the computer computes a form of music itself, he never used the outcome untouched. So the final piece is always retouched and the results are chosen and there is a montage according to the intuition of the composer. So this is algorithmic process, but still the composer is giving his hand to compose the final piece. I would like to now continue with the topic, how we can implement such distributions in C++ environment. So Juice has a very good random class. And the Juice website offers a tutorial for it. And this is the link, but you can find it easily by Googling it. But the interesting thing is also with the tutorial, it just gives the example of the uniform random distribution. The random class is a uniform random distribution. And the tutorial discusses of some weighted probability distributions, but they are again simulated with the uniform random distribution. Therefore, I find it important for people who are interested in developing more probability distributions in C++ to watch this. So first thing is like you define, for example, in your header file, a random object with the, here I use the randval. And then we can get a uniform distribution result by using the method called nextfloat. So there is also a globally shared object version of that, but also the documentation says that it's not thread safe. So although it's a bit faster, there is nothing wrong to use your multiple random objects whenever you eat. So you don't need to really use the globally shared object. And you can, of course, query your distribution results in float, integer, double, and Boolean form. So the next important thing on this topic is the seed value. So these random objects are pseudo-random generators. So they use an algorithm and the computer simulates pattern, which is not perfect because that pattern has a probability to repeat after a certain time. But this is why it's called pseudo. And there are many, many algorithms simulating these random patterns. So what do we need to do next is like use a seed value. So each value generates a different pattern of random distribution. So for example, if you type zero, it starts like that. And if you set z one, it starts a bit similar, but then diverges to other, another pattern. And you can use in Juice class, the set seed randomly function so that it uses, I guess, the system clock and other conditions to set the seed randomly for you. And another thing to do is define some margins for your random distribution object. So you can say that use this distribution between a minimum and maximum value. And I have typed for you an example method for that. And inside this method, you see the first step is the set the seat randomly, and then return a value of that object, random object, inside these margins. And so I switch next. And how can we implement other probability distributions? So let's implement the exponential distribution of which curve you can see on the right. And there are three example lambda values. And the x function, probability distribution function, people say also probability density function, PDF in short, for this kind of definitions. And px is 1 minus e powered by minus cx. And c here is the lambda parameter, actually. And what we need to do is we have to solve this equation for the variable x. Then we obtain this formula, x equals minus ln, and the rest, as you see, sorry, I cannot read it very fluently. And then instead of px, I mean the PDF, we replace this with a uniform random distribution. So I typed as a method for you this exponential distribution, which takes a lambda parameter as input, and then returns the value of the distribution according to the formula what we have above. And this is how you can simulate or obtain the exponential distribution by typing the code directly and using the random object of the juice class. So now let's implement the Poisson distribution, which is a discrete distribution. And again, we start with its probability distribution function px. And you see the method there, which I used. And again, you see inside the juice random object, which generates the floating point uniform random distributions. So in general, define the probability distribution equation against the event space X. So choose your probability distribution, in other words, and solve the equation for X and replace the Px in that formula with a uniform random number generator. Another possibility is, because not every equation is really easy to solve against X, and sometimes it's not possible. And there are methods like you can use tables, like a wave table synthesizer. You can generate tables of probability distribution values, and then you can ask these results to a table randomly also. But I would like to introduce you to the random library of C++ 11, which is very handy. And they use the following pseudo random number engines, but I use the default random engine, which is the top. So some people prefer the others. And it's easy to access as just typing the include statement at the top of your header file. And then you define a generator object for the default random engine. And next we seed it. And you see it's called generator. It's the seed method and with a specific seed value. And the last line on this page is an example how you can get the system clock to seed or to simulate as a random seed, which you have already in juice class. With this random library of C++ 11, accessing to continuous or discrete distribution methods are relatively easy. You don't need to type any formula. And here are the examples for normal distribution, in other words, it's the Gaussian distribution, the same name, or the Cauchy distribution. And you input your parameter, the distribution parameters, both of have two parameters. And then you define the normal distribution with these parameters. And using the default random generator, you get the result, return the result from the method. And the same is also for the Cauchy distribution. So This is basically how you can obtain random distributions in C++. And next, I will give you some sound ideas, what they can do in by using the existing SonicLab software. So of course, things have changed since Xenakis, and we have many synthesis methods available, and each of them have their parameters. We have filters and other phenomena which affect the sound. And beginning from the ideas of Xenakis, I have tried to take them further and then implement these in modern sound synthesis tools in form of software. So my main contribution to Xenakis idea has been this figure there. As I explained to you, he was using a time cell and distributing these events inside. So I expanded this idea by using the fractal approach and consider this, the upper time cell as a macro event, and each event distributed inside this macro event, I name it as meso event, and each meso event expands to a microspace. And inside this space, I have these micro events. And all these are distributed with probabilistic distributions. And this we call top-down distribution. And this augments the time scales of the initial time cell idea. So we have multiple time scales running together. And each event can have their own modulation curves and multiple of them. So how do we construct the audio with that? I begin with the micro event. So I put a sound source to each micro event. I calculate the space, and this becomes the meso event, and this space becomes the macro event. And this is called bottom-up construction of sound. So I will change the screen, to Ableton Live, which you know. And there, I will open this. I will start with this Wallbot application. So this is a sound which I input to this modulator. And I'm changing the amplitude with this function. And this is arc sine distribution, which has these parameters. And the rate function. I have to decrease this, you see? Or I can choose the waveform itself here. Let's say sine wave. Change the rate. Now it looks like a sine. I can modulate the rate of the frequency of that with this function here. So the frequency of the sine wave is modulated with a stochastic function. Okay? So now I have here three instances, and this is the server and two are clients, and the same sound source also playing, one playing the C, A and E here. So I'm turning all of them together on. Let's make it like that. So you see, I open these as well. I have three audio tracks, and this server controls these clients. For example, if I increase the rate here, you see, it instantly sends the command, the parameter change to the clients as well. But they use the same stochastic function, the same parameters, but the outcome is as you see, different. It's this different iteration. So, and this. So this is basically mixing three tracks at the same time with this stochastic distribution. And in a way that it is really hard to difficult with editing methods on at all. Let me show you some examples. This one is like small cuts in the sound. And you see the visual aspect of distribution as well. I'm changing the offset of the curve. So I think this is enough for this case. This can generate also CV output signals so that you can use this curve to modulate your external gear and also use scales to use it as well as a pitch modulator. So I'm passing to my second example. This one is a filter where we will modulate the filter parameters. It's actually a filter bank parameters with stochastic distributions. So here it is. So this needle represents our filter, one filter. Let's choose leather type filter and. The audio cracks a bit here. And this is using now uniform distribution. I'm changing the rate. And this is using this gen function. These are functions to stochastic functions to modulate the filter frequency. These are barriers where I limit the distribution. It's like min max value. And from this noise, I will generate wind sound. This is 10 resonator filters I'm using now. And they are fading out right now and then they will come back. Okay. So this nice natural movement is created by stochastic distributions. So it nicely simulates the creepy sound of stormy wind. So let's stop that. And here I open Fundamental, which will play us just the sound. It's a bank of sine waves. And let's use, so these three filters are four filters actually, filtering this sound. But I'm using this discrete function to change the amplitude of the gain of this each filter. You see? This is the parameter of the distribution. So it's like fading in and out each filter. And each filter is like responding to a sine wave coming from the fundamental. So this was the example of using stochastic generators with filters. And now I want to share my other screen and let go this crack. And this is a video I created for presenting Cosmos F Saturn, a synthesizer using stochastic distributions. Here I start with a very the simplest audio construction. It's a Dirac impulse. It's one sample length of audio. And what can we do by distributing these impulses? Here it is. I hope you have sound.
Yep, all good.
Now changing to uniform distribution so that each impulse is randomly distributed in time. I'm changing the density of the distributions. And now I'm using the Cauchy distribution, which is like now the firecrackers as we have listened before. And I'm convolving this with a reverb. I'm changing the speed of meso events. I'm increasing the density. And introducing some filter modulation as well. Back to uniform distribution. So, as you see, this is a lot of information computed and applied so many sonic entities to form up such a structure. And this is pure computation. So it's an audio design, which we can actually call computer-assisted audio design. So, and I don't touch anything. I don't do any montage, just there is the flute stream of computed events in an algorithmic manner, which then sounds like a real ambient texture of a natural phenomenon. So I will continue with another example. So how about imitating some Xanapkis music with this kind of applications. So this is his piece called Safa, piece for percussions. I play a little extract. Oh, sorry, not this one. This should be played. I used an Indian drum sample. It will not sound exactly the same, but that's not the purpose, but you will feel the similarity. Next, I think if I do full screen, scale to fit screen, the videos don't play well. So I will use a smaller scale. So this is the real-time audio processing version of CosmosF. You know, there's FX plugins and also instrument plugins. So this is an FX audio FX plugin, where each event is filled up with the incoming audio. They act like a buffer. So first you will see the dry sound, you will hear the dry sound, and then the processing. This is the dry. Is not, they are not individual, but I think on a computer. So I have last examples here from Fundamental and Thermal, and for that I have to stop this share, and then so I need just another 5 minutes maybe share the screen back. Not bad. So I choose this Zen Morph. This is an application which uses a test equipment sound, an eight of these oscillators, and it drives them with these the same mechanics of generative audio synthesis, which I used in the other applications like Passport. So I forgot to turn on the application. So I will use a stochastic distribution to morph between these points. So this is an example of generative synthesis, where we use just sine waves, but all these processes come up with a unique symphony of sine waves. We change the parameters all in continuously and without doing much by hand. So the last example is thermo, which is my latest application. It's based on thermodynamic principles, where it's a system which tries to hold conditions in equilibrium, but there are ways to perturbate these conditions. And the particular force behind them is, again, the stochastic function. So because they work on themselves, and then the system tries to give a response to that. And I have an example here. You see the distribution, it's the responsible of this dynamic change in the audio. And the system is trying to respond to that with filter modulation. And I turn this method off, and it becomes a dull, not very interesting sound. But if I activate it, and along with this distribution, it generates the sound, which moves by itself and generates this quality. You see the reaction is here. This curves up. This was an example of a more hybrid system, generative system, where the stochastic functions were taking part as modulators, the system perturbators, like they act on parameters so that the thermodynamic structure responds to that. And this we hear a sound. And this has different examples here. So these are changing like that. Here I simulate a system error. These parts are coming in and out. So the industrial quality of the sounds, and which are pure synthesized sounds, come from the algorithmic roots of the system. So this is a good example where which level you can reach by using a good combination of systemic structure to synthesize generative sound synthesis. I hope this was useful for all of you, and I'm not really a teacher, but I just wanted to make sure that to give you as much possible as I can in that limited time. And so thank you again for this opportunity to the audio programmer team. That's it.
Thank you very much, Sinan. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Yes. And thanks so much for showing some practical examples of how to get started as well. I think that will be very helpful for people who are looking to get into this type of programming. So there have been a couple questions, and you showcased one of these earlier, but there was a question from Afrologic asking if these techniques have utilities for sampled sounds as well. So you did one that used the Indian drum. I wasn't sure if that was generative or if that was
exactly that was generative by the direct. It was direct recording of the output of the application. So that application can use samples. I can I have some standard oscillators, additive synthesis, some Karplus strong synthesis, and also sample. I can load samples to each micro event there, and so that's a full blown synthesizer, which can use all these techniques as an input.
Amazing. So Liz Dexic says, I love the client server arch on this, makes sense in a multi-channel presentation.
Yes.
And was part of that running on iOS as well?
Yes. Wallbot, Passbot, and Fundamental. I mean, it's only the Wallbot which has this server client architecture, and Cosmos M31, which I didn't show here. They have this server client structures, and the purpose was there. Like I use like a networking, Juice networking class for that. And actually, I had the idea, but I was not sure if it would work inside the DAW or not. But it turned out like after several experiments and then trial and fails. And it's working, so it's pretty fast. I mean, you change one parameter and the other clients are affected instantly, maybe 1 millisecond later. So, but it's not that important. And the idea is like you have a generator and the copy is clients of it, like clones of it, but they iterate different results. So why not applying it to multiple tracks at the same time? Because this is a problematic in DAW. Maybe you have ways to achieve this in Ableton Live, but other DAWs have no connection between tracks like that. So you cannot communicate or assign tasks to share between tracks. So I think this can be useful for other ideas as well, not just stochastic synthesis. Yeah.
And Liz Dexic had another question. It said, asking if you're working with these on a single sample level or using buffer sized chunks of data?
I think I understand the question. SonicLab software does not use optimization. So, sorry, only Passport uses vector optimization. The rest uses sample level calculation. So, because of the fractal structure of the Cosmos F, for example, I could not implement a healthy design, this vector optimization, because the nature does not work like that. In nature, the nature is fractal, and it's continuously fractal. So I have chosen not to use a vector-based operation. So each process is a sample long, single sample long operation, which takes a lot of CPU, but that's the sacrifice.
Yeah, that was another question, which was about the CPU usage. So looked like the CPU usage in Ableton was sparking.
No, it's. I think it was for, because I was using the Zoom as well.
Yeah.
And I don't suggest you use the Zoom and its audio driver and these applications at the same time, but you can safely use your professional audio driver and these applications. So it depends, of course, on your computer. My new M1 notebook just is in service at the moment. So this computer is like maybe 10 years old. It's still i7, but the new M1 notebooks are pretty strong and handle very well all these type of applications.
Nice. So Liz Dexic also said that he's working with Microsound for his PhD, and he was wondering if you have published any papers he would like to review and
sure. a lot, actually. So if he can reach me to Sonic Lab email, like support at or Sinan at sonic-lab.com, I can send you maybe the papers, maybe the list of it. I don't know. So I have to look where to find all the PDFs again. But I have published in Computer Music Journal, MIT Press, International Computer Music Conference, New Interfaces for Musical Expression Conference, and Digital Audio Effects Conference, all during my PhD studies. I mean, the all these actually the purpose of this software are to bring it to all this research to wider audience, and the research was done much before during my studies. I have some I had some attempts to do them also in Max MSP, but up to some level. It's never like programming it in C++, of course. And this kind of structures is very difficult to do, maybe impossible to program in object-oriented like environments. So you have to type the code. I mean, use programming language, which is the best for the computer. That's why JUICE entered my life in 2013, before even it was acquired by Rolly. So the first version of Cosmos F was in open frameworks, interestingly, and it was not a VST, it was an application. And then when I switched to JUICE, I was able to take out the plugin and stand alone the Windows, Mac versions from the same code almost.
Holonic Systems asks if you've ever tried changing parameters using real-time, real-world data. So like data from space or anything like that. Ever tried that?
Yeah, it's possible. I mean, me as a sound designer, no. But you can analyze this data. I guess Holonic Systems has these tools. So, and then map it to the controllers of any application because it's easy to assign the application parameter sliders, UI controls on Ableton Live, and then let them drive with MIDI controllers, isn't it? So it's the basically do that. And then if someone has done it, I would like to hear, of course. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. So that seems to be all the questions from the chat. Thank you very much, Sinan, for that presentation. That was really amazing and very unique as well.
Thank you very much for this opportunity and the audience. I hope we will present this in YouTube and so that the people can refer to this quote at least whenever they want.
Yeah. Absolutely. And if you have any links, you can share them with me afterwards and I'll be happy to post them with the video.
I will do. Okay.
Fantastic.
Thanks.
Great. So with that, right before we move on to Daniel's talk,